Jordan's subjective perspective.
You know, if you like touch one of those, like it'll break very easily. Like if you like grab it. Not like the light bulb, but the thing around it.
Wait, like the light bulb protector thing?
Yeah. I know that from experience.
Those are like plastic, right?
Yeah, so like...
They're like bendable plastic.
Yeah, well, when they get really hot, and if you like... I don't want to say like if you touch it, but like if you like grab it, it like breaks, like showers.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's really interesting, because I haven't like touched that plastic too much, but I would assume... Like it looks really malleable, like really like... I don't know, it's just going to bend to your will almost.
Yeah, it won't.
Really?
Don't want to fake.
And then, that's interesting.
It's so fake.
No, because the heat on there, you think it would get, like, even, you think it would be, like, more gooey, and not, like, it's, like, flex, like, not as, like, shattery, I guess you'd
say. Yeah.
Like, it would just get more bendy.
Yeah, I don't know. I know, just, like, a few times, like, I didn't think it, and, like, I, like, squeezed it or something, and it just, like, shattered, and I was like, oh, nope, didn't mean to do that.
I thought you were talking about the light bulb. Like, just squeezing a light bulb.
Yeah.
I was like, I wouldn't do that.
No, I would never.
Some shards of glass in your... deep inside you.
That'd be awful. That hurts so bad.
Well, are you... You said you're a little bit nervous.
Yeah.
Yeah. I feel bad because people always ask me, like, what are we going to talk about? And I never know what to say. I'm like, honestly, like, we'll come up with a few topics and we'll talk longer than you think. But it's, like, a new experience for somebody.
Yeah.
So it's, I don't know, it's kind of hard to explain, like, yo, this can go in, like, any direction. That's kind of, like, the fun side of it, like, the spontaneity behind it. But, so my answer to that question, like, what we're going to talk about, like, where this conversation might get really weird, it might get really interesting, who knows, you know?
Okay.
So just believe in the uncertain with it. That's my advice. That's going to be my new answer. Honestly, right. Whenever people ask me, like, what are we going to talk about? I'm just going to be like, believe in the uncertain, young Padawan.
There you go. That's what I would do.
Actually, I just got new microphones, and so it's going to get, like, more legit. So this might be, because right now this is what's recording us, so I figured I would keep this mic here so that it's, like, taunting us, if that makes sense. Like, it's just kind of sitting there, staring at us, staring us down right now.
More like staring at you, but yeah.
Hey, all right, I'll flip it around. No, not staring at you.
I feel like I'm on a talk show.
It kind of does look like that. Like,
yeah.
That's what they always have them, like about this far distance away. You know, like, not too far, but...
But, like, yeah, far enough.
Yeah, no, so, like, do you know who Zlatan Ibrahimovic is?
Who?
Zlatan Ibrahimovic.
I have no idea.
He was on a... He was on Jimmy Kimmel the other day.
Oh, was he? I don't watch Jimmy Kimmel.
Yeah, really?
Yeah. I like Jimmy Fallon better.
Okay, absolutely.
Yeah.
He's a charismatic, goofy guy.
He's hilarious. I love him.
Like, do you watch him, like, on actual time, or do you watch him on YouTube?
I mean, I do, like, a little bit of both. Okay. I mean, I don't, like, necessarily watch him, but, like, if he's on and I'm, like, watching TV, I'm like, oh, hey, I'll watch this.
But Jimmy Fallon greater than sign Jimmy Kimmel.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Understandable.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
Yeah, I feel like I pretty much only watch them on YouTube. Like, somebody will pop up. They might have, like, a guest I like or something like that.
Yeah. Like Ariana Grande.
Yeah.
She's, like, my favorite.
So. Really?
Yes.
What do you like about her?
I don't know. Like, she's very empowering. Empowering?
That's what I think.
Yeah.
I think a lot of women are very drawn to her. Like, she's like a...
She's, like, she doesn't care. Like, she's very out there and outgoing and, like, outspoken.
Okay.
And, like, she just doesn't give a shit.
Okay.
And, like, I don't know.
So, do you think she's, like, do you like how she's... Wait, is this recording? Oh, it is. Okay. Sometimes I get, like, really, like, almost, like, paranoid to the point I'm, like, all right, is that recording? Is this recording? Just because, like, the possibility of it, like, of me pushing something and not working. But anyway.
Yeah.
I feel like she's a very empowering, like, feminine figure.
Yeah, oh,
because
for sure.
I feel like, I don't know, like, do you think that a lot of, like, girls in general kind of care too much, or not too much, I mean, that's left open to interpretation or debate, but care enough to the point that it draws, like, insecurity, so it's really, like, empowering and cool to see like a feminine figure like oh yeah, she's independent, she's doing her like
oh, yeah. No, and she's very like body positive and like she'll call you on your shit. And she's just, you know, she's gone through a lot and like we've all seen it and like she shares with us and not like a lot of celebrities do that. Like they want to just kind of hide away with their problems, you know what I mean? That's why like I feel like most of them turn to drugs.
Mm-hmm.
And stuff, so.
So she's very, very open and she's almost going through her problems with the rest of the world.
Yeah. And watching. Like, yeah. And she shares it with everybody.
Think about how strong you have to be to do that.
Oh my gosh, you'd be so strong. I couldn't do it for sure.
That's crazy.
Yeah. Like 10 billion people in the world.
That takes like a lot of, like it takes a lot of confidence, but on the opposite, it also takes a lot of humility.
Yeah.
That takes a lot of humility to be like, I'm only human. I made mistakes. I'm going through something right now. I'm only, what is she, like 25 or something
like
that?
Yeah, she's like 25. And you know, like when she like makes a mistake and like people call her on it, you know, she apologizes. It's not like she's like, oh, I'm not in the wrong. She's like, you know what, I was.
Uh-huh.
You're right.
That's really cool.
Yeah, and it's just like, damn, like I want to be here. Hello. Like, who wouldn't? It's like awesome.
I think it's a lot of people almost look down on like, on looking up to celebrities and stuff like that. You know what I'm talking about? Like some people, they're like, oh, I don't care about the public eye. Like it's my life. Like I don't care what celebrities do. You know, like that kind of subculture, like it's more of a reaction, not necessarily a culture, but like this like anti-celebrities kind of thing. But I think that's really cool because there's some like clear value that you've gained from like Ariana Grande, you know?
Yeah. No, like, I don't know. I personally love her. I love her music. Mm-hmm. I think she's an amazing singer. Like, she's very inspiring.
She's talented.
She's very talented. Like, I wish I could sing like that. I think a lot of people do. That's like real talent. Not a lot of people have that, like, no offense, but Britney Spears, she can't sing for shit.
No. Uh-huh.
And you know, it's just like, I think it's almost bad that we put somebody in the public figure that's like Britney Spears, who only cares about her look and her image, where Ariana Grande can walk out in sweats and she wouldn't give a shit. She'll flick the camera off.
Uh-huh.
Like, whatever. I'm a person. I'm a human. Whereas if it's Britney Spears, like she feels embarrassed and then she's like upset.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
So her confidence to wear what she wants and care about her, like her image and whatnot, but not like too much.
Yeah. Yeah. And like, yeah.
That's really cool. Cause I don't know. I just think, I don't know. Like I'm just trying to like, not play devil's advocate, but kind of bring up like that counter argument to like, oh, it's stupid. Like, why? I kind of get like where they're coming from. They're like, why should we put celebrities up on this pedestal? They're humans just like we are. And I would agree with that. I would agree with that 100%. But like to just completely discount them, it's like, I don't think that's necessarily the right approach to just be like, oh, they're celebrities. Who cares about them? Because I don't know. They're ultimately accomplished people. And I'm not saying like all of them are like, I'm not saying like all of them you should look up to. Like a lot of them you probably shouldn't look up to be honest. But like there are a lot of really cool celebrities out there. And if we have like the medium and the platforms to connect with them and get what they're all about, like I think there's some value to be gained from that. Because like you can implement that same kind of confidence that Ariana Grande possesses and has like to your own personality and be like, you know what? Like right now at work, I just went through something. My boss just yelled at me or whatever. This just happened to me.
Yeah.
But what would Ariana Grande do in this situation? And whenever you're kind of like lost in that situation, it's not like you're trying to like replicate and be her. It's like, okay, I'm kind of lost right now. Like my response, and you might as well be able to reach out and seek out as many given resources as you can possibly like cling on to, and like Ariana Grande being one of them. Like you know what? She has this kind of like, not like a not fuck you confidence, but kind of. You know what I mean?
It's, I don't know how to explain it. Like, it's more of, I'm me, and if you don't like it, you don't like it.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't say it's more of a fuck you. I feel like it's just she's being her real self, and that's not a lot of people can do that, honestly.
And she doesn't care about the consequences, the judgment that's going to result in her being herself.
I mean, I feel like she does have that a little bit, but I mean, like, everybody has that. But
absolutely.
I mean, she still, you know, expresses herself no matter what.
This is, like. It's really cool. That's really cool.
Yeah.
And think about all the people she's distilling confidence and empowering. Like, all the young women, all the, I mean, oh, I'm sure there are a lot of men, too, but she's typically more of a... more of a female dominant kind of thing.
Yeah, well, and I think, you know, like her brother, Frankie, I believe he's gay or bisexual, something like that. But like, you know, like she has, you know, all these types of friends and she's like very cultured and she knows where like a lot of people come from. So does she, like, you know, she is Italian and all that stuff and la-di-di-da, and, you know, she can relate to a lot of people, and I feel like that's why a lot of people like her, because she can relate to almost anybody.
Mm.
And, like, she wants to build that connection with her fans, like, on a personal level.
And you can sense that, too.
Yeah.
It's impressive. That's impressive that she's able, like, it sounds really genuine. It sounds like, because I'm not super familiar with Ariana Grande. I just know like a lot of people like her, and she's like, she's almost more than a trend at this point. Like some people are really popular in pop culture for a little bit, but I feel like Ariana Grande is just like a very important figure, and she's making net positive impact on our culture.
Oh, for sure. You know, and she's been in headlines for how many years now?
Yeah, yeah. She was on Nickelodeon before that.
Exactly.
Yeah. I remember my sisters used to watch that show all the time when I was, like, pretty young. Yeah. And she was, like, the dumb, like, redhead or something. Yeah.
Cat.
Yep, yep, yeah.
Cat Valentine. I mean, I'll admit it, I watched it, so.
There you go. Victoria Justice's show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that's where my love grew for Ariana Grande, so. Mm-hmm.
So you're an original fan.
I am. I'm an original fan, for sure.
That's cool. That's really cool that she's brought so much value to your life.
Yeah, for sure.
And millions of others. That's crazy. What do you think of her song Thank You Next?
I love that song.
Uh-huh.
Like, it just, it's like a big, like, thank you for being my ex. You've made me learn lessons that I need to learn to go on to my next. You know what I mean?
Okay. So, like,
thank you.
No, no, I'm happy you said, like, your interpretation. Yeah,
yeah.
Because I was actually about to ask you that. But, yeah, yeah. That's really cool. That's really cool. Because I feel like that's better than a lot of people's reaction when they're like, fuck you. Like,
they're like, oh, like, this is about my ex. Like, fuck my ex and stuff like that. Like, no, like, I think it's very, a lot of people are just like, oh, she's just promoting it because she went through a breakup. No, I think it's because, like, she's very grateful for her exes and the lessons she's actually has learned to make her the person that she is now.
Yeah, yeah. That's like, that's always, honestly, that's always the approach I've always seen. Like, thankful for that.
Yeah. Like, you can't, you don't live life if you don't make mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, for her to go out and admit, like, you're a mistake, but thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you for making me realize that.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, thank you for making me go through the most, like, painful love of my life. Whatever it was.
Or not even necessarily, like, seeing them as a mistake, but just a lesson.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, like, this isn't necessarily what I want, but I don't know. There's a lot of, like, value, too. Like, I think a lot of, like, this is really prevalent in dating, but, like, whenever you kind of, like, meet different personality types and different communication styles, different, like, habitual patterns, just different people in general, you kind of, I think it's really important to figure out what you don't want, too, like, while you're going out throughout, because then whenever you can, like, ultimately make, like, the, I guess, final choice or whatever, like,
yeah,
for somebody you, like, really want to spend a significant amount of time with, it's like, okay, like, this is what I don't like, so these are, like, some red flags to look for, this is what I do like, this is, I don't know, just kind of, because it's, like, kind of, like, soul-searching within yourself, too.
Yeah, like, I feel like people come into your life to help you learn lessons, mm-hmm, and to make you grow as a person.
Absolutely.
You know, and like, it's not necessarily like you have to be hurt by the experience, but it's just, you know, it makes you who you are.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, it's kind of like the mindset of just taking on life as a student, just like trying to figure this thing out.
Exactly.
Yeah, I was trying to stop and reflect and be like, what can I learn here? Like, this sucks right now. Like, even some things, just objectively and subjectively, they're just like, oh my god, this is terrible. Like, this is not good that it's happening. But it's like, what can I learn here? And that's a hard question to ask sometimes.
Exactly. I mean, I don't do that. I just kind of like wait till the answer comes to me. And I mean, probably shouldn't, but you know.
But as long as as long as you get that answer, you know.
Yeah. I mean, there's a few things that I still am like, why or what in the world?
Absolutely. Happened?
So, I mean, but I mean.
Because it maybe just repressed it. You're like, okay, like, forget that even happened.
Yeah. Like, not, I mean, like, there's a lot of people like that. Like, I'm like that. Like, when my dad passed away, like, a few hours after being told, like, I was very giddy and I was like jumping up and down and I was just like, I just basically like acted like it didn't happen. Like, it just wasn't there.
Isn't that the first step? Like, denial?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sure. Oh, interesting. Really?
Yeah. So, like, even like when like something happens to me, like, I don't like to talk about it. Like, I just act like everything's fine.
Were you kind of coping with maybe a sense of humor even?
Yeah.
Like, not in a disrespectful way or anything, but just like trying to laugh about stuff. And exactly. Absolutely. No, that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, like, I just get my mind off of things.
Mm-hmm. Because sometimes it's just too much to hit your mind with at once.
Oh, and especially when you just turn 12 and your dad passes away. Like, it's just like, it's a big shock.
Yeah, it's like so surreal that it doesn't even seem real.
Yeah.
That's absolutely insane. Wow. Yeah. I'm sorry that happened to you, huh?
Oh, that's okay. I mean, it's been 10 years, 10 and a half years.
Okay. Well, actually, going back to the thank you next, I'm kind of like, I guess I'd say like fearful that the counter response to like thank you next is that people, because we live in like a weird time to where we have more options with like dating and all of that. Okay, let's stay on the topic of dating. I mean, you could apply that to just capitalism and consumer choice as well. Mm-hmm. To like all these freaking options we have, like Amazon and all that. Like, anything you want, you can pretty much figure it out.
Yeah.
But as far as dating goes, like, I guess I'm like kind of fearful of the interpretation that's like, thank you next, to where like people just never are able, they're never satisfied. You know, it's like they're never like content with like somebody. They're always moving on, always moving forward. And I don't know if that's necessarily a good or bad thing, but I could see people responding that way.
I think that there's just some people out there who are never satisfied and they're always searching for something.
Mm-hmm.
Like, something better. Like, they think that there's always something better out there.
Mm.
And so, like, and their mindset is, I can find something better. Like, I've been with this long enough, I think there's something better out there. And, you know, I feel like when they get to a point where they're like, this isn't better. This is not what I want. Like, I want to go back. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So, like, there's just people out there that have that mindset that there's, I want to move on. Like, I want something better than this. And it's just being materialistic.
Do you think that's just whenever the kind of like the costs of something kind of outweigh the benefits?
Yeah.
Or they hit like a breaking point in the relationship and they're just like,
they're like stuck.
But I feel like for some people, that breaking point's so quick. You know what I mean? Which, like, I don't know, where's the security in that kind of person? That's scary, you know?
Yeah.
Like,
oh, gosh. Yeah.
It's like as soon as something goes wrong with them, it's like, all right, I'm out. Bye.
Exactly. And I think those are the people that you just kind of like really like talk with and work with and like show them like, I'm here. Mm-hmm. I care. Just, you know, and if they take you up on your offer or if they don't, then there's nothing you can do about it.
Yeah. I wonder what leads somebody to be that way. Like, you know, like childhood.
Yeah.
If it's like nature versus nurture, if it's some past trauma
or
just the mindset of like,
I don't want to. I feel like something tragic has to happen to put you in that mindset, though.
Okay.
So, like, going back to my dad's death, like, I shut everybody out. And so, like, and I still do that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I've worked on it, but, like, if something, like, really hurts me, like, I don't talk about it with the person. Like, I just have to walk away.
Uh-huh.
And I just, like, I can't talk about it for, like, a few hours and sometimes a few days.
Interesting.
And that's just, like, how some people are. And that's why when, like, if it's very early on in the relationship and something goes wrong, that person just, they think it's very easy to get out. So they go. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So.
Which makes sense, especially early on.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a book I'm reading right now. It's called The Paradox of Choice, and it's pretty much like saying how we have like so many choices, and it kind of like, I don't think the book says this word, but or this expression, but it's like choice paralysis, to where the point that we have like such a plethora of options that we're completely overwhelmed, and it's almost like a stunning situation to be in. That it leads us more hesitant to make a choice because it's so difficult to choose at that point in time. And like one chapter, it talks about like the two different approaches, kind of like what we were just talking about, very, very relevant to what we were just talking about. And one is the satisficer and one is the maximizer. Mm-hmm. And the satisficer kind of has a set of standards, expectations, ideals, that whenever they go throughout life, they're like, okay, whenever this gets met, then it's good enough. And it's not like they're like settling. Like they have an idea of what they want. They have an idea of what they don't want. And when they figure out what they do want, it's like, okay, this is good enough. This is good enough for me. I'm happy. I'm satisfied. And on the contrary, they're maximizers, that they want the best possible outcome or the best possible choice. So it's they would be like the more quickly to like move on to something new, whether it be like a nicer product, a new boyfriend, girlfriend, or X, Y, and Z. They want the best possible outcome. And obviously, it's not like somebody's like 100% this or 100% of that. Like I feel like everybody's a little bit of mix of the two.
Yeah.
Like everybody's kind of looking for something that's good enough, but at the same time, they're looking for something that's like.
That makes them happy.
Yeah.
That satisfies them.
Yeah, yeah, satisfies them to the best they possibly can. As many benefits as possible. As few cons, I guess you'd say. But like, people are realistic too, I think.
Yeah.
To an extent. So, but the book argues if you're more of a satisficer, you're going to be psychologically happier. Because, really? Yeah, because a maximizer, the author argues that it's going to lead to a lot more discontent, always wanting something better.
Yeah.
Which makes sense. It's like an endless desire of like, oh, maybe I can do better. Maybe I can do better. Like, and that question can eat you alive at points.
Yeah. And I think people who are like, that deal with like OCD and perfectionism,
mm-hmm.
like I think that's, they deal with that. And then. They're always thinking that question. Like, I can do this better. What can I do better?
Absolutely.
Like, this isn't perfect to me. Like, what's wrong with it? You know what I mean?
Just being, yeah, like obsessively a perfectionist.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
Because I feel like there's not too much wrong with, like, being a perfectionist, but at the same time, like, being a, there's probably, like, some sort of, like, balance between the two. Like, I don't know. I feel like being a perfectionist is a little bit different than being somebody who wants like the best possible outcome. I just don't know what it is. Because I feel like being a perfectionist is, it's at bare minimum like admired. Like,
yeah.
I'm thinking like the Michael Jordan psychology, or like just somebody with like that relentless like obsession. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? Like, I feel like that's like kind of, I feel like that's a net positive overall, but if you're kind of like trying to maximize your choices, then.
See, with like perfectionism in like my eyes, I feel like they want to be the best and they want the best things. And they like, they're constantly like competitive and they're just trying like extremely hard. So they're never satisfied.
Mm-hmm. always working towards that.
Always working towards something different. Like, I want this, I want this, I want this. I want to be better at this. I'm going to be the best at this. You know what I mean? Like, there's just some people like that.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, like, I see what you say, like, what you're saying about, like, people being dissatisfied a lot. And they're never finding that happiness, so. But yeah.
Yeah, that's interesting. That's interesting. Yeah, I would agree. Because, I think that obsession's really healthy and really cool. Like, I really admire that. But at the same time, it's like, when is that obsession actually destructive? Because I feel like there's, like, that fine line to where...
Oh, yeah.
Even if you're reaping a lot of, like, benefits of, like, worldly success, like, there could be a lot of shit going on in your personal life.
Yeah.
Like same deal with, like, Michael Jordan. I didn't even know that so recently, but Michael Jordan was, like, a huge gambler on the side as well.
Really?
Yeah. So, like, his, like, obsessiveness with basketball would, like, convert into, like, unhealthy things as well.
Okay.
So it'd, like, convert over to gambling and shit like that.
Huh. I did not know he gambled.
I love that concept, like, to where something, it's kind of like the tragic hero concept, to, like, where something is so extreme in a personality to where it's, like, led to, like, so much of their worldly success, but simultaneously it's led to, like, some, like, chaos in their life, too.
Yeah.
I don't know why I'm so attracted to that thought. Maybe it's because I see a little bit of that in myself. I don't know. I don't know why I like that so much, but I love that thought, like, so much.
Yeah.
But, it's weird.
I mean, I don't know. I don't know what to say. I don't know.
Well, your glasses are cracked, I notice.
They've actually been cracked.
Did you get a fight?
Yes, with a shark. Obviously. I don't have any scratches on me.
Well, why are you wearing goggles instead of...
No, a bunch of drunken nights in college, you know, the dorm, tile floor, missing my nightstand multiple times.
Okay.
And they just eventually started cracking. I mean, I've had them for like 5 years. So, I mean...
Oh, that's actually impressive then.
Yeah. I mean, people are like, your glasses are cracked. And I'm like, yeah, I know, but like, I don't see it.
Oh, you don't see the cracks?
No. Which is like weird to think.
That's all that's right all that matters, here. Right?
Yeah.
That's all.
I mean, I can still see, so I...
Yeah.
I'm fine. Yeah. I mean, I should go get my eyes checked and get new ones, but who's got the time for that?
So how much can you see? How's your vision work? I'm not like super familiar with vision.
Oh, it's so bad.
Really?
Yeah, so like, if I take my glasses off...
Can you see me right now?
You're a blur.
I'm a blur?
Yeah, like where your eyes are, they're like black. Okay, like you're blurry, you're not a blur, but like...
I'm invisible.
But I'm like, I can like see like your shape and your outline, not uh-huh. Like I go like back further, like over here, like I would... That's a TV, right? Yeah, sure.
Back there?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a TV.
Yeah, like I would never know. Uh-huh. I didn't know that.
That's not even that far away.
I know. Like, yeah, you're more than welcome to look. I wouldn't advise it.
I know if you keep these on, it can, like, damage your vision, right?
Yes. Like, my vision is awful.
Wow. So, this is your vision? Is that how that works?
Like, that's, like, my vision corrected.
Right. But how does that work? How does that work? Though, where they are able to figure... these are custom made for you.
Yeah. So, like...
I've never thought about this before, really. That's, like, absolutely insane.
Do you have, like, contacts or anything like that?
No. Really? No, I've just never had to deal with glasses before. Like, fortunately, I just...
Yeah.
That's absolutely insane that they're able to customize to your vision. Like, they're...
So, like, have you ever been to an eye doctor?
I've been to an eye doctor.
Like, how many times, though, in your life?
Well, they touched me inappropriately, and I never went back, so...
Oh, really?
I'm just kidding.
No, I, like, believed you.
Yeah, I was a part of the Me Too movement, my eye doctor.
Yeah.
No problem.
Normally I wear contacts. I just ran out, and I just have yet to go get some, just because I've been so busy. But what they do is, like, they can look at, like, your depth perception, your sphere, the sphere of your eye, and like if you have astigmatism and like how bad your vision really is, and they like do like certain eye tests. So like there's like you're in a dark room and like they'll dilate your eyes and they'll be like, there's like a picture of their house and like they'll puff air into your eye basically. And then they'll like ask for like, how far away is it? Can you see it? And then you go in and you actually see like the actual eye doctor.
Mm-hmm.
And then he'll like go through tests of like, you're like this and you have to like read letters from afar. And then like he'll put down lenses and ask you like, which one's better? Which one's better?
So they're constantly measuring.
Yeah. So like they're constantly measuring like your depth perception, the spherical of your eye and like just all of it.
Okay.
So it's so like, it's a lot.
All these attributes that go into your vision and then they somehow manipulate like the glass to reflect a certain way.
Yeah. So like, I don't know how to, I want to say it's like almost like a magnifying glass.
Uh-huh.
If that makes any sense.
But it's like a magnifying glass that makes you see, I don't want to say correctly, but like more optimally.
Yeah. Like a correct, I think it corrects my vision. Okay. But I mean like,
I didn't know if that was unfair to say.
What
like,
do you mean?
Just like saying like, so these people see correct and these people see like incorrect. Like,
I mean, I'm not gonna like be mad that you can see correct. I mean, right. I'm a little mad because you don't have to experience like the glasses and the contacts and stuff.
Right. Well, not in like a hypersensitive way, just like a word choice way, I guess you'd say.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean,
I'm PC, you know? I'm PC, bro. I was watching a South Park last night that I don't really watch that show, but they were making fun of the PC culture or whatever. That's
really?
Why, yeah, that's why I said that.
Oh, I was like, I don't know what he's talking about, but I'm just going to go with it. but yeah, no, that's crazy that you like don't have to wear eyeglasses or contacts.
Like a fair amount of the population.
I don't know why. I guess like if you're a person who has to wear like glasses and contacts, like you automatically think a lot of people around you like wear contacts or glasses.
Yeah, I wonder how much like of the general population, like how much of the American population or even just world population wears glasses or should wear glasses.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. I want to say a lot.
Okay.
I feel like, I don't know. Maybe not. Maybe it's like 50-50.
That's almost what I'm thinking. Like,
yeah, because like one of my really good friends, her name's Danielle, she doesn't have to wear contacts or glasses or anything like that. She's never had to correct her eye vision or anything.
Mm-hmm.
But then like our friend Erin, she wears glasses just like I do.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, I don't know, maybe like 75.
And it's also one of those things, like you can get to know somebody pretty well and not even know they have contacts or like...
Oh, yeah.
You know, like, it's especially somebody who, like, literally never wears their glasses. Like, they always are wearing their contacts. Like,
yeah.
I've had friends where I've known for years, and I'm just, they just, like, take their contacts out one day. And I just don't think about it, because I don't have anything like that. So they, like, take their contacts out. I'm like, you wear contacts? And they're like, yeah, absolutely. Do you? I'm like, no. Like, I just didn't know that about you, man. That's crazy.
So, like, in your perspective, do you think, like, do you just, like, not think that people wear glasses and contacts?
I obviously know, but I'm not consciously thinking of it.
Yeah.
Like, I see it, and it's not like I see it as a fashion statement. Like, I can conceptually, like, think that. Like, if somebody's like, why are they wearing glasses? Like, okay, obviously, they have, like, impaired vision, so they need help with that. Or
yeah.
With they're disabled. That's what I said. No, I'm just kidding.
Oh, wow.
No, they need glasses to serve this use. Like, obviously, but I just don't think, like, oh, that person might be wearing contacts right now. Like, that person might, I guess it's one of those things, like, you don't think of the problem until
like
you
somebody,
deal with it.
Yeah. Yeah, like, for me, like, I can tell when somebody's wearing contacts.
Because,
like, if you're, like, looking them in the eyes, like, you can see, like, the blue ring around. Or if they, like, blink or move their eye, like, you can kind of just see it, like, quickly move back.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean that I know that because I wear contacts and I basically see it firsthand.
Yeah, so you can pick up on that a lot easier. Absolutely.
Yeah. So like to me, I am always constantly thinking like somebody's always wearing contacts or glasses. Like I don't think they have correct vision.
Like you're always anticipating it.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
So like you saying that like, you don't have to wear contacts or anything, it's mind blowing.
Mm-hmm. It's just something I'm just like not very observant of whatsoever.
Yeah.
That's really interesting.
Huh.
Just, yeah, whenever, I guess you or a loved one, like whenever you're very familiar with a certain way of living, I guess you'd say, like you're going to be a lot more aware of it.
Yeah.
And I'm completely oblivious.
I also think like eye vision is also hereditary. Cause like all of my family has had to have like glasses and contacts.
I would definitely believe it is.
Yeah. Except my dad.
Oh, really?
Yes. So, like, I don't know. I
would guess so, because I usually see, like, entire families with or without glasses.
Exactly.
Or, I mean, they're mixes as well, but
yeah.
For the most part.
Yeah. But, I mean, like, I don't know. Like, my grandma wore glasses. My grandpa wears glasses. But, I mean, that might be just because they were at an older age, but, like, I don't know. I feel like my grandma always wore glasses. But maybe, like, it skips a generation or something like that.
Okay.
I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know how that works either. That's interesting to think about.
Yeah.
I've always, like, seen it that way, that it's hereditary. A lot more, like, innately out of your control.
Yeah, I feel like a lot of things are like that, though.
Oh, absolutely. Honestly.
Like, majority of things that we just don't think of.
What interests me is, like, what concepts of your personality are completely hereditary. Or not completely, but, like, majority speaking. And, like, how much of that is learned.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like, I just think of so many things that go into, like, this bundle of, like, who I am. Like, and, like, how much is that? Is that completely just because I came from this lineage of family?
Yeah. Well, I don't think that, like, aspects of, like, your personality are, like, hereditary. I feel like you learn them from the people you're around.
Because,
mm-hmm. you know, you see those people that change when they start hanging out with, like, a different group of people.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, getting the mixture of, like, your parents, I guess. I forgot where I was going with this.
Mixture of your parents.
Yeah, so, like,
I do that all the time.
Like, it's like a psychological thing.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, if, say, one of your parents are terrified of dogs,
mm-hmm.
you're more likely to be scared of dogs
because Absolutely.
You learn that behavior. So it's not like, I feel like your personality is, like, more based on, like, behavior you've observed and learned over time.
Okay. Some more nurtured side.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was wondering, a good example for me is my dad is the jumpiest guy I know. Like, he will fucking jump at, like, I don't know, you don't even try to scare him. You just kind of creep up on him, and he will, like,
yeah.
Oh, he will get so scared. Versus, like, I'm pretty calm most of the time as far as, like, that goes. But if you, like, really catch me off guard, then you can get me good. Right. Like, you can scare me.
Yeah. Oh, but, it's so easy to scare.
Really? Like, yes. Most of the time, I'm not super easy to scare. But, like, every once in a while, that whole limbic system just comes out. Where I'm just like, oh my god, I just get petrified in that moment.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I wonder if that's like just because of like how jumpy my dad is. Because it's kind of like out of my personality to be that way.
Or I mean, it might just actually scare you.
Yeah, true, true.
I mean, I don't know.
It's probably just my natural response to being frightened.
Yeah.
But I was wondering if it's like, okay, because that's my father, that's why I'm so jumpy in that situation. But it's very, you gotta get me right. You gotta get me good.
Really?
Yeah.
So, like, if I, like, came down the stairs when it's, like, dark and just, like, jump on you and you didn't know?
If I'm not expecting it, then, yeah, okay. I get pretty scared.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Fair enough.
My roommates have gotten me good a few times.
Really?
They've also failed a lot, too, though.
I get scared so easily.
Sometimes, like, if I'm, like, just not anticipating it, oh, it's good.
No, I get my friends good, but then, like, they can get me really good, so, like, one time I was taking a shower and one of my friends, I didn't even hear them come in. And I did this to them. Like, I, like, opened the shower curtain and, like, clear liner. I, like, just, like, stuck my head right there. And, like, they just, like, turn around and they just, like, scream bloody murder. And they had, like, no idea it was me because, like, it was foggy.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, they did that to me, like, the lights. I was having a problem with, like, my overhead light. It was just, like, flickering. And, well, they turned it off. And I was like, you know, whatever. Like, I'll just continue my shower. Well, next thing I know is I just see the curtain open, and then it's just like, oh, I literally heart attack. It was the worst experience.
Oh, it's wild. That's a good, yeah. I'm always like happy when people scare me though.
Oh, I hate it.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Do you get mad at them?
I don't want to say I get mad. Like, I laugh, depending.
Uh-huh.
Now, like, they're my friends. I'm obviously going to laugh because I know it's a joke, but, like, going to, like, Fright Fest, this is an actual experience, but, like, I'm petrified of clowns, as most people are. And they were over by, like, the Batman ride. And so, like, you know, everyone's like, just don't look at them. Just don't pay attention. And I'm, like, freaking out. Like, my head's down. I'm just like, don't make eye contact. They'll leave me alone. I just see one coming up. And I just, like, was like, nope. So I take off running. And, like, one was chasing me. The other one saw me, was chasing me. And then he, like, went around a corner the way I was coming. And he, like, jumped out and, like, just scared me. I screamed bloody murder. I cried. Like, I was so mad.
Mm-hmm.
I was so scared.
Wow.
So, like, those kind of things, yeah, for sure. For sure. Now, it was just, like, you coming around a corner and just jumping out and saying boo. Like, I'm going to scream, obviously.
Are you going to hold a grudge, though?
No. I will get you back, though.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah, like.
I just started a war at that point.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Prank wars.
Yeah, I started, this is a story worth showing. I'm going to expose my roommate real quick.
Okay.
So I was like, I parked in our like lot in my house and I was backing up and I saw like that I got kind of close to my roommate's car. So I texted him. This was like last year. I texted him like, hey, I'm so sorry, man. I just hit your car backing up and I apologize. And before he even saw it, and I sent him a picture of his car and it was completely fine. Like, completely fine. And that was my way of, like, letting him know, like, hey, I'm joking. And before he even saw his car, he calls his entire family. And they're, like, calling the insurance company. They're, like, freaking out.
Oh,
I go
God.
To class. I'm not checking my phone at all. And so I don't check my phone for, like, 3 hours. And I open up my phone, and he still hasn't seen his car yet because he was, like, gone all day for whatever reason and didn't have an opportunity to go to his car. But before he even sees his car, before I can check my phone, they're on the phone with insurance agents, all this chaos that I'm causing in his like inner family circle.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, I'm so sorry. I didn't realize like how much like trauma I caused you guys.
Yeah.
You and everybody else. And then I apologize and he's like, all right, you started a war. So like the, like 2-3 days later, he poops on a plate and leaves it in my room. I'm just like, you're disgusting. That is like one little harmless prank to like whole new levels.
That's oh my God.
Isn't that fucking gross?
Yeah, like, what the fuck? Who comes up with that?
He does, apparently, right?
Yeah. What in the world?
I know. Yeah, I would not, I didn't think that was a good, like, I thought he brought, like, something from here, and then he got his response is why his was so traumatic. And then he went way up here. I was like, you need to chill.
That's not even like a prank. That's just gross.
Yeah.
That's just disgusting.
I walked in my room and
was it like?
It was like in there and then I go, you get that the fuck out of there right now. And he just started laughing so hard. I let him have his fun, but it was in my room for like 30 seconds. So.
Ugh.
I was like, you get that out of there. And
was it like animal?
No. Like he pooped on it. Like, yeah. Like he pooped on a paper plate. Put it underneath my bed. Or waited for me to like leave the room real quick. I like went downstairs. I come back up to my room. It's in my room. I can smell it immediately. I see it sitting there right there on the floor. And I knew exactly who he's in there dying laughing. I'm like, I turn right to him, like, you get that the fuck out of there.
Oh my God.
That's what happened. Oh, it's disgusting. Disgusting.
Boys, Jesus.
Yeah.
That's awful. Ugh, I couldn't do it.
But he.
You should have taken his like face like a dog and like rubbed it in there. Yeah. Like,
smell it. Spank him a few times. Just degrade him.
Yes. Like, do it again, I swear.
Oh, that'd be great. Have you ever had one of these bang things?
No, actually, I've never tried one.
Really?
Everyone says they're good. But...
Hey, sponsor me. Sponsor me, bang. This is like my first time. This is the most I've ever drank out of one.
What flavor is it?
This is probably like a fourth of this thing. I'm not going to drink it all. Cotton candy. You want to try a sip?
Sure.
It's zero sugar, so.
Might as well.
Do you ever drink like energy drinks?
No, I have never drank an energy drink.
Anymore. No, no way. Yeah, I've had like sips of Monster and stuff like that. But
it smells good.
Apparently that doesn't have much of a crash, which is cool. That's what I've heard.
Oh my god, these are so good.
That's okay. Really good, right? That's zero really calories good. And zero sugars. It's like, how? I don't get it. Well, it's just all zero. Zero fat, zero cholesterol, 2% of your daily sodium, some potassium, no carbs, no sugars, no protein. It's just like,
okay,
it's not even like an excess of vitamins either. It's like a pretty healthy amount.
What's the ingredients though?
First is carbonated water, citric acid,
okay,
anhydrous, natural flavors, caffeine, something, sodium benzoate.
But I bet you it has a ton of caffeine in it, though.
Sucralose. I don't know what that
that's,
is.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but I feel like that's like an amino acid.
Oh, really?
No. I'm sorry. Maybe.
I don't think it is. An amino acid, but I could be wrong.
Maybe it's like a type of sugar.
That's what I'm thinking it is.
Yeah, that is.
Like sucralose.
Yeah.
But how does that not get counted as sugar? Do you think there's
well,
like a...
Well, okay, so like, I took nutrition.
Uh-huh.
And like, FDA states if it's like below like 0.5, I believe, they do not have to put it on the label. So like, if you see something that says like zero trans fat, it could have a little bit of trans fat. But they don't have to say that.
Okay, like, I don't find that even like unethical. Like, I don't see a problem with that.
Yeah.
So they just do just enough to say zero, like 0 grams of sugar, but.
Yeah.
Well, at least it's. I don't care as long as this doesn't have like 30
grams of sugar.
Or it's an artificial
sweetener.
That's scary.
That's exactly what that is, an artificial sweetener.
Oh really?
I swear on my life.
See, I'm always skeptical whenever something tastes this sweet. Like, this is sweet, right?
That is sweet.
Like, this is really sweet. And...
But, I mean, like, the citric acid, though, kind of... Well,
that's pretty bad for you,
like,
right?
I think so.
Really?
I'm not sure.
It's probably acidic.
Yeah. It's not good for your teeth.
No, really?
Yeah.
So I shouldn't swish this around? Oh, goodness.
Probably not the best idea if you do it every single day.
Yeah, I was going to say, some of this, Yeah, some of this, like, I don't know, I just, anything like this, even if it is, like, super good for you, like, I try to stay away from it, I don't know.
Yeah, I don't trust it.
Yeah, I'm a little skeptical,
like,
too.
Energy drinks are energy drinks, I can't talk. Like, I don't know. Like, Monster, what is, Rockstar is the one, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, this, like.
I'm always skeptical, absolutely.
Yeah. Like, I mean, how many milligrams of caffeine's in the thing?
That's a good question.
Should say it on there somewhere.
I used to be such a nerd with like looking at the nutritional value of stuff.
Were you one of those people in the grocery store that stopped and looked at every single label?
More so when my mom bought groceries, because this was more like back in high school.
Yeah.
But yeah, I would say I'm still kind of that way for sure.
I definitely do that with most things, not all things.
Oh, wait, I'm supposed to avoid caffeine right now. I just remembered that.
Oh, well.
Yeah.
Is that a New Year's resolution? Oh.
No. Yeah. It's actually funny because I started this literally a year ago. I started drinking caffeine like a year ago. Well, I'm doing... Yeah, I was actually planning on talking about this.
300 milligrams of caffeine.
That's a lot, right?
Which is more than 2 cups of coffee.
Okay, that's a lot,
only for one of these. So, like, people who drink multiple of those a day, like, that's insane. Like, I know somebody who drinks, like, 2 of those a day, and I'm like, how? That's
crazy.
That's insane.
Yeah, how? I think that's my last sip of that, just because this is, like, something I really wanted to talk about. So, I'm doing this thing. It's called Reiki. It's in... My friend, I'm doing it through one of my friend's moms. Actually, that same friend that pooped on the plate. So it's like, it's my roommate's mom. And, I don't know, it's called a Reiki attunement, like a emotional alignment.
Yeah.
But, she sent me this, like, article thing, which is why I'm on my phone right now. I'll read the little intro real quick. But one of the rules on doing this Reiki ceremony thing,
yeah,
because I think this is gonna last like 6 hours during Saturday or something like that. Yeah, so it's like a pretty intense like spiritual type of like I don't know exactly what it is. Like I don't know if there's like it's like a healing process.
Okay, like a meditation camp.
Oh, pretty much like very very similar. Yes, like it's I don't know. Like it's
sounds intense.
Absolutely, very absolutely. Intense. So I'll read you like this description of what she sent me. A Reiki attunement is an initiation into a sacred metaphysical order that has been present on Earth for thousands of years. By receiving an attunement, you will become part of a group of people who are using Reiki to heal themselves and each other, and who are working together to heal the Earth. Interesting.
Okay.
By becoming part of this group, your connection to the spiritual qualities of life will become stronger and more meaningful. If you have a religious background, your connection with the spiritual aspects of your religion will become stronger as well. The attunement is always a process of empowerment that opens your crown, heart, and palm chakras in a special way as to connect you to a source of Reiki energy. During the attunement and for a time after, changes will be made by the attunement energy to enable you to channel Reiki. So it's almost like saying it's like a type of energy?
Yeah, so this makes me think, I don't know if this is what it is, but when I was a sophomore in college and I was cheering, a stunt went wrong and I came down on my ankle because I was a flyer.
Mm-hmm.
And I strained the tendon that goes from like, basically, your foot all the way up to your knee.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually still have the bruise on my ankle, crazy enough. But I was on crutches, and I was working at a tanning salon. I was a manager. And this lady, her name's Terry, she was the coolest freaking 80-year-old I have ever met. She was so sweet. She didn't even look 80. And she came up to me, and she's like, "Can I?" And I was like, at first I was like, sure. And I was like, I don't know what you're talking about, but sure. And all she did was like, she's like, "Okay, just close your eyes." And I was like, "Okay." She's like, "Just relax." And like, she puts her hands on my ankle.
Mm-hmm.
And like, she just like sat there and like closed her eyes. And it was like, she was like, she explained to me that it was like a type of energy that she was trying to heal my ankle with her energy.
Uh-huh.
So it was like, I don't know, that's what makes me think of that. I don't know if that's what it is.
That's really interesting.
Yeah.
Did it actually help?
I want to say no, but like, I don't know. I feel like it kind of did.
Okay. Interesting.
Yeah. Like I'm like wishy-washy about it.
Okay.
Like I feel like it took the pain away for
she's kind of closed bit. Her eyes and just
like, yeah,
grabbed
like,
your like, hurt ankle.
Yeah. And just like, I don't know, like sat there for like maybe 5 minutes.
Wow. Interesting.
Yeah.
Because so, I think there's something related to, like, another person being there to where they're kind of, at least, like, what I was looking at on YouTube, like, it was, like, it almost looked like a back massage or something like that.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know if she, I can't remember if she rubbed, but I do, like, specifically her, like, grabbing my ankle and, like, just holding it.
Do you remember what it was called or anything?
No.
That's really interesting, though. That's cool.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I'm really intrigued by those, like, metaphysical, like, healings and spiritual cleansings, like, stuff like that. I think it's interesting. I think it's worth being open-minded to. I'm not saying I, like, fully believe it and say this is how it is, but I'm open to the idea.
Yeah. I think it'd be cool. I don't know if I could do it, though. Just because, like, my mind wanders a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, I can't focus for too long.
Right.
In a sense.
Yeah, that's something I struggle with too, for sure.
Like, if I just, like, if I'm already bored,
mm-hmm.
like, my mind will just, like, wander off. And, like, I can literally, like, stare at you and act like I'm listening to you, but I'm, like, totally not.
Right, yeah.
Which is so, like, it's so bad, like.
I think we all do that.
Yeah, but, like, you can always tell what I'm doing. Like, I'm like this, and I'm like, And then, like, I kind of, like, just, like, my eyes kind of, like, glaze over a little bit. And then, like, you say something, and I, like, respond with a yeah, or
Exactly.
Yeah, like,
exactly.
It's so bad. I'm so bad at it.
I think that a lot of people do that, yeah. Like, more than we want to admit.
Yeah. Oh, like, driving.
Uh-huh.
Literally, like, there'll be times where I kind of want to, like, say it's almost like a blackout because I don't remember, like, how I got there.
I know what you mean.
Yeah, like, you, like, just, like...
It's almost like a blackout in a weird way.
Yeah, like, you're doing it, like, it's like you're on autopilot. But, like, once you, like, come to, you're like, holy shit, like, how did I get here? Like, I don't even remember going over a bridge or getting into this lane. Like, this morning, I did that, and I was, like, I was getting on 270 from 70 going to work, and I got, like, over, like, three or four lanes, and I, like, came to, in a sense. And I'm, like, did I even have put my blinker on? Did I even look? Like, how did I get over here?
Yeah.
Like, how did I not just crash?
So I always wonder how we're just working, like, autonomously sometimes. Yeah. Just, like, on autopilot. That's a really good way to word it, because you really do, like, do... And driving's a great example. Like, you totally, like, do stuff, and you're like, wow, I was, like, not even present for that. Like, it was just... It was happening, but I wasn't thinking about it happening. I was thinking about this, and that's what, my mind was on.
Yeah. Or, like, even if you don't think about anything, like, you don't have anything in your mind. Maybe, uh-huh. Maybe that's just me, but, like... I could be thinking about nothing, and it happens.
Right. That's crazy. Yeah. That's absolutely insane.
I feel like that's not good. I feel like that's a little dangerous, but...
Probably still thinking about something, though. You might have, you just forgot what you were even thinking about, though.
That, too.
You forgot what you were thinking about, like, and then forgot what you were even doing.
Exactly. Like, maybe, like, a daydream or something like that.
Uh-huh. I used to have a big problem. School conditioned me to be a big daydreamer.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, it worked my more, like, creative side, I guess. So I was always, like, hyperactive. Like, not like that kid that was, like bouncing always, up like, and down. But, like, mentally, I was always just thinking about something in school.
Yeah.
To where I would do, like, what you said. Like, I would teach myself, like, what the... Like, the teacher would talk for 20 minutes. And I would always have a friend in the class. And I'd look over to the right. And I'd have my friend sum it up in, like, 30 seconds, whatever we were doing. And then I had to figure out on my own from there. Like, that's how I went through school. That's literally, like, how I did school. So, it makes you, like, a quicker, you gotta learn a lot quicker, but you also fuck up a lot, because I literally didn't hear a word the teacher said for the past 20 minutes, because I was thinking about this and this and this, but, the point being, like, school definitely conditioned me to be, like, somebody who zones out a lot.
Yeah.
But it's weird, because the podcast has made me, like, way more attentive. That's definitely, like, one of the net positives.
Yeah. But it's probably because you enjoy it, though.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So, like, I feel like things that you enjoy, you pay more attention to versus things that you, like, you don't really care for.
Mm-hmm.
Then you're just kind of, like, you're there.
That's definitely the way my mind works.
Yeah. Like,
and then I've read a book, because I was diagnosed with ADHD. And I was actually skeptical if I even had it for, like, a long time. But after reading this book, it was called The ADHD Advantage. And the argument was, like, there are advantages to having this if you know how to work it. Like there, this is a really cool thing if you know how to work your mind. And that's what I kind of learned, like, kind of developed a self-awareness, like, after being diagnosed, that I was like, okay, like, I've noticed, like, me in comparison to my peers, like, I'm better at this, but they're a lot better at this. So, like, just trying to, like, I don't know, the book helps you, like, work more optimally. But why did I bring that up? Oh, that's, like, that's a big reason, like, what they were arguing in the book. They're, like, because the constant paradigm that, like, culturally, at least in America, that we view, like, ADHD with is, like, you see ADHD and you're, like, okay, just give him some pills. Let's give him some Ritalin, give him some Adderall.
Yeah.
Diagnose that child and get him on some speed. And that's, like, our solution, but...
But I don't think it works.
It definitely isn't the most effective route, and it's... The school system, in my opinion, just isn't catered towards those with ADHD, because your brain is just going, like, all day long. Exactly. Like, that's just how it works. And to have you, like, to force you to sit down for 7 hours, like,
I feel like
school is difficult.
Oh, I bet. No, my nephew, he has ADHD, and he basically takes Adderall.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, I can always see it kick in. And, like, I almost feel kind of bad because, like, it's almost like taking his personality away.
Interesting.
Like, it's like, it's a totally different kid.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, when he's not on it, when he doesn't take it, like, he's here, he's there, he's here, he's there, he's creative, he's, like, you know, he's constantly, like, on the go, constantly doing something.
Like, more reserved? Talking. Like, what's the, like, what's him without Adderall, him with Adderall?
So, like, him without is, like, him constantly going and talking, and
mm-hmm.
when he, you know, Adderall gets thrown in there, he just, it's almost like he shuts down, like, he's quiet.
More reserved.
More reserved, he doesn't do much.
Interesting.
And it's like, you're not yourself.
Interesting.
It's almost like they try to, like, in a way, like, suppress, like, you're not supposed to be that kind of person, so here's this to make you normal.
Right, right.
You know what I mean?
That is definitely a response of Adderall, too, and that's yeah. that's how a lot of people respond to it.
Yeah, and, like, the thing is he's, like, oh God, I'm a terrible person. I think he's 8 or 9, or he's gonna be 9.
That's really young. That's young to be taking that shit.
He's been on it for maybe a year. Yeah, oh my God. And it's, like, you know, it's...
I will say I wish I took it less in high school. Like, just in general, I wish I took less Adderall my life.
Yeah. I just feel like it's, like, a gateway to, like, different drugs.
Could say that. Because,
like, your body's going to... His body's going to get used to it eventually.
And it's eventually he probably already is.
Yeah, and it probably... It's not going to work anymore. So, you know, they had to put him on different stuff. And then, like, you know, he's constantly switching medications. And that's just, like, once they take him off or whatever... You know, he has to find something because his body craves it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just, it's awful knowing that when he was 8, that's, he got put on it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's definitely a different response than what I feel whenever I take Adderall. But it's, yeah. I get that because a lot of people definitely get that way.
Yeah.
They get more closed up. And it's definitely, it's a definite personality altering substance, for sure.
For sure, yeah. No.
Whether that be good or bad. Because sometimes I get more talkative whenever I'm on it, too.
Really?
Like, to the point where I'm actually, like, a shittier listener. And I'm just, like, I'm just talking.
Yeah.
Like, I'll let you get 2 words in, and then I'll start rambling again. Like, I'm just on my feet, on my toes. Like,
yeah.
But it's more like a speeding thing. It also just makes me like stuff I don't like doing.
Yeah.
Like, it can make me focus on, like, schoolwork that I just hate doing normally.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of a cool benefit of it. But that's interesting how much it alters his personality. And it's almost like I'm kind of imagining, like, he has this, he's like this big sporadic box that's like this big,
mm-hmm.
just massive, and then the Adderall almost seems like constraining to where, like, it just limits his, or maybe it's the same size box, but takes a lot of the energy out of it.
Yeah, like it's like the box opens or something like that.
Yeah, let some out.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, I feel like going back to, like, what you said about, like, schools and stuff like that, I feel like, you know, there's the kids who can't, like, comprehend or can't read, you know, they put so much focus onto them. Why can't they do that for kids with ADHD?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, maybe, I mean, God bless the person who would ever want to do this, but, like, you know, have just a class where it's just ADHD kids.
Yeah.
And, you know, like, teaching them the way they function. Versus making them function how every other child is supposed to function.
That's definitely, like, optimal and definitely, what's the word I'm looking for? It's almost like a, I don't want to say a fantasy land. It's almost like a utopian version of what school should be.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it's like, I don't know if that would ever happen.
I mean, I don't think it would.
But I do think there would be, like accommodations. Like, that's pretty much what we're saying right now. It's like, yeah. Accommodations need to be taken for those students. Because the reality is they learn in a different way.
Exactly. They don't learn like everybody else.
Uh-huh.
And, like, when I was younger, I still have a problem with it. But, like, I had a speech impediment. I couldn't comprehend. I couldn't read. And I still have that uh-huh. problem. Like, they didn't
Are you
really
dyslexic?
Fix it. I want to say I am,
uh-huh.
just because, like, things, like, to me, like, if I, like, I don't know how to explain it, but, like, if I, like, look at something really fast, like, I'll read it completely wrong.
Uh-huh.
Like, one time there's...
You get a glance.
Yeah. So, like, not even, like, even at a glance, like, just sometimes, like, I just read it wrong. And, like, me and my mom went out one time, and I was looking at the bill, and I was, like... It's $62, and she goes, it shouldn't be. And I go, it's $62.73, and, like, I'm looking at it upside down, first of all.
Uh-huh.
But it was $26.37. So, like, I was, like, flipping these two numbers to here.
Do you think it was because you were looking at it upside down, though?
I don't think so. Because, like, even I turned around and I, like, looked at it and I, like, told her the same thing.
Oh, really?
And then she, like, pointed out, she goes, no, it's 2637.
Interesting.
And so, like, once she, like, made me look at it, then I'm like, it, like, all, like, made sense. But, like, I don't know.
But you think, like, your mind would be able to interpret that simply without mixing it up like that?
Yeah.
Do you have any other examples? Like, has it been prevalent other than that?
I mean, like, I'll, like, read different words and then people are like, that's not what it says at all.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, that might be dyslexic, honestly.
Yeah. I mean, like, I've never been, like, physically diagnosed with it.
Uh-huh.
But I think there's, like, something there. Because, like, there's words that I just, like, I can't read.
Mm-hmm.
Which, embarrassing to say, which I just said on a podcast.
Yeah.
But, no, like, yeah, it's just, I always hated reading in class. I hated reading out loud, like, popcorn reading.
No, I hated that, yeah.
Oh, my God. That was the worst.
I always hated that, too.
And I was, like, I was always, like, I feel like it created anxiety.
Absolutely. Because,
like, I was always anxious that I was going to get called on to read something.
Oh, and I hated getting called on.
I know, and I'm, like, and I just, like, when I would mess up a word or I couldn't read a word, like, it's embarrassing.
Oh, it's really embarrassing because then they're like, oh, that person can't read.
Or they're dumb. Or, yeah. They start laughing and then, like, you know, it just, like, makes you feel really self-conscious.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. I always thought that was not a positive thing to have in class either.
No, I don't think it is.
Because I wouldn't even sit there and, like, retain what we were talking about in class. I was just anxious that I was going to be the one that get called on.
Exactly. Like,
I was like, oh my God, is it going to be me? Is it going to be me? Please don't be me. And then every time it's not you, it's like, yes, yes.
Like, yes, but I got to read the next paragraph.
Yeah. So we have five more people to go. Like, they haven't called on me yet. We've had three people get called on so far. What's the probability of me getting called on right now? There are 24 people in the class. 8 are the total are going to be called on. That's 1/3 of the class. 3 are down, so only five out of the 24. But my probability is looking good that I'm not going to get called on. Like, your mind's running.
Exactly. And, like, you're reading it and you're like, is this the right? Is this how you say it? Like, is this right? And then you're like, okay, it's right. But then you have to, like, read it again. You're like, are you sure? Like, you second guess yourself.
Yes.
And then, like, I remember, like,
popcorn reading.
Oh, my God. It was government. And, like, the teacher was like, you can read, you have to read at least two or three, I can't remember, sentence minimum, and then you can change. And I was like, that was so stressful for me. And, like, I just, like, I remember just kind of, like, crouched down in, like, my desk. And I'm like, please,
nobody
pick me. Do not.
Don't pick me.
Exactly. I think I got lucky and I didn't.
Uh-huh.
Which, I'm not a very lucky person.
It was just always, yeah, that's funny, yeah. Just that relief. I totally remember that relief of not getting called on.
Exactly. But, you know, what I did like is that, like, you know, like, the line, like, reading, I guess, like, one person would read this, and then the next person, like, and you knew who was coming next, and so you knew what you were gonna read.
So you read it a few times.
I read it, like, down over and over. So, like, as you said, like, you don't retain anything because you're so, like, stressed out on this one thing that you have to
read. Yeah, absolutely. You just, yeah. So we're letting the dog down here.
She's probably like, where are you?
So let me just open the door and let my dog down. Alright, I guess she's joining us.
Hey, Charlie!
Hey, you should pick her up.
She likes me better.
She'll be on camera. She'll be a star. The camera's about to die.
Isn't it?
Hi. Charlie, you're a star.
Look.
You're a star, Charlie. Right at the end. Wow. She wants to get in on the action.
Hi. There you go. Come here. She's camera shot.
She's going back. Oh, she's.
She's like
so cute. So cute.
She's adorable.
It's cool how much dogs have personalities, too.
I know. Well, there's, like, a study saying that, like, dogs are dumb. Like, they're, like, cats are smarter. So I think that's what it was.
Well, just comparing the two?
Yeah, and I'm just like, how? Like, cats lay there all day, and they don't do anything, and, like, you know what I mean? And then there's, like, dogs, they're always doing something, they're always in your business, and, like, I feel like they pick up your habits.
Okay, yeah.
And they create their own personality.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, my ex's dog, she was, like, she's a very big personality.
Mm-hmm.
And she, like, she'll talk back, for sure. Oh, she got her ball. But, like,
I'm not about to play with you right now, Charlie.
But, like, you know, she, like, you tell her no. Like, I remember when you go, like, no, she'll, like, bark back, and it's almost like she says no. There we go.
She's gonna want to play with this.
Hi. Hi. She's, like, more intrigued about the ball than anything else. But, yeah, like, you tell her no, she'd bark back, and it was almost like she says no.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, she always knew when I had, like, my camera out, like, on my phone and stuff, and I was, like, trying to take a video of her.
She'd tell?
Like, she could always, like, tell. Like, I guess, like, it's just a way that I, like, hold my phone.
That's interesting.
And, like, I have,
she
like...
She would act different?
She would act different, yes. Like, and I have videos to prove it, and, like, you can tell her, I'd be like, smile, and she'd be like...
That's really... Yeah.
Or, like,
interesting.
If I'm, like, this, and, like, she's, like, laying on me, and if I, like, have my phone like this, she'll, like, just, like, throw her head back and just, like, I don't know. Maybe it's just her being weird, or it's just, I don't know.
I love the personalities.
Yeah. Like, it's just, like, a different personality.
It's so cool. Just every dog's a little different.
Yeah.
Aww. Do you have any other topics on your mind? Actually, something did pop in my head. So back on the ADHD topic, the reason I brought up that book and everything so much, oh, the camera's done. It's all good. It always does. So it only has
are
like
you sure it's dead?
Yeah.
Oh, there it went.
Yeah. Where was I going with that? So the benefits of ADHD are pretty much like you said, like when you don't like something, you're like the worst focuser in the world on it.
Yeah.
But, like, whenever you like something, you're, like, you have this ability to, like, hyper-focus. And that's kind of, that's what the book argues a lot, and that's what I realized about myself, like, growing up. I was, like, I have this really cool ability whenever I like something. Like, I'm, it's just, like, a weird thing. I don't know. Like, I just noticed it. It's, like, way more extreme than, like, other people versus on the opposite end, it's whenever I don't like something, it's, like, the extreme of, like, I'm terrible at it. Like, absolutely yeah. awful at it. So it's, that's kind of interesting. And that's like one of the really cool advantages of it if you have the self-awareness to know it. But also dyslexia has a lot of benefits too. Like, do you know who Richard Branson is by chance?
No, I do not.
He's like a millionaire entrepreneur, dude. Like he's like one of the most famous people, or one of the richest. And like he started the whole Virgin line, like Virgin Mobile, Virgin Airlines.
Oh.
He has his own private island. Like he's a cool guy. Like he's a really cool dude. And I don't know how much he's worth, but he's worth a fuck ton of money.
Okay.
And he started a dyslexic sperm bank.
Really?
Because there are like benefits to being dyslexic, because you just see the world in a different way. I think there are like creative benefits and.
Huh.
Yeah, I'll Google it right now. It's actually like worth looking up.
Yeah, I'm intrigued.
Yeah, it's kind of cool to think about all the. The little things that go into, I don't know, you see them as disorders, but really they're just like, I guess you'd say like mutations or like adaptations to like your environment. So like there are certain advantages and disadvantages to a lot of adaptations. That's how I see it at least.
Yeah.
Wait, what was I looking up? Benefits of.
It's a pretty big yawn.
What's he doing?
Just I want my ball.
I don't want to put her down now either, because she'll, improved pattern recognition, good spatial knowledge, they're picture thinkers, sharper peripheral vision, business entrepreneurs, highly creative, seeing the bigger picture. People with dyslexia often see things more holistically. So it seems like, I don't know, probably a con of that is like you see the whole picture, but like some of the small steps in it you might not focus on as much. I don't know, that's kind of cool to think like there are like benefits to this, because I don't know, like a lot of people you see, like you hear dyslexia, you're like, oh, that sucks, I'm so sorry that you have this disadvantage of life. But what people don't tell you, what it never gets mentioned, is like the positives too. So it just It just comes down to like the self-awareness. If you identify that you have this, whatever you want to call it. I don't even want to call it like a disorder, because it's like they're positive, so it's not even necessarily a disorder. But if you have this thing that makes you less normal, if you have the self-awareness to like apply to like, okay, like I know this about myself, I have this advantage from it, but I'm bad at this. Like, just learn how to focus on your strengths and kind of avoid your weaknesses at all costs.
Yeah. Huh. I had no idea. It's interesting.
That is weird to think about.
Yeah. But like, now that you like say it, like I can definitely see a lot of it. For sure, yeah. Like things that like I do.
Mm-hmm.
Huh.
So you think you might have it? Based off like some of those things?
Like some of those things, yes.
Are we about to diagnose you on this podcast?
I think so.
Really?
I'm dyslexic, y'all.
Y'all.
But like, yeah.
Write down all the things we
talk about. Oh, I'm not even gonna be like Allie's dyslexic. I'm just gonna be like, wow. But yeah, and the, like, I don't know. Business, like when you said like something about like business and stuff like that, like, sorry, your dog just like totally like distracted me with like the cuteness. She was just like I don't know, it was so cute. But like, they, you know, like they were saying like business entrepreneurs and stuff like that, like I've noticed that like I'm like starting to like do things on my own, like businessy wise. So mm-hmm. like I like make these like little like I call them cookies in a jar. Mm-hmm. So like it's like all the ingredients, but then like on like a glass bottle it has like the how to make it and stuff like that, you know what I mean? Like I can show you a picture later, but
how to make what?
Like the recipes, like the recipe for the like cookies or like shortbread or
the ingredients in a jar so they can make it themselves.
Yeah, and so like it's like basically it looks like it's stacked. So like the bottom would be like flour, then your sugar, then like brown sugar, and then like the chocolate chips or like oats and whatever salt is in there as well, like the baking, like it's all in there.
Oh, so you sell all the ingredients kind of individually, they mix it up themselves.
Yeah, so like I'll put it into like a jar. Mm-hmm. So like it makes it look nicer.
Absolutely.
And then they'll have the recipe. All they have to do is just kind of like just pour it.
Absolutely. And then just mix it up with water or whatever. Yeah.
And so, put some eggs in it. That's about it. I can't really.
So what do they,
put an egg in the.
Absolutely. Jar. So like, do people actually buy this? Is it pretty. So like you just kind of sell them on the aspect that, it's like this unique recipe for making cookies.
Yeah. It's like a good gift giving kind of thing.
Okay, absolutely.
So, like, you know, somebody who likes to bake a lot. Oh, excuse me.
Oh, so you'll sell it to somebody who's getting it as like, a gift for somebody else. Absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, there's some people out there that might just, like, want it just so lately they don't have to deal with buying all the ingredients and stuff like that. I also, like, you know, like, took it upon myself to, like, redo, like, my dresser from when I was a little girl.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, I, like... It looks really nice, by the way. But, you know, like, I did that myself. I didn't watch any videos or anything like that. I just kind of did it. And, like, I, like, want to, like, start doing that myself. Like, I want to start, like, a business and that kind of, like, aspect of, like, buying furniture and, like, reselling it.
Absolutely.
After redoing it. Mm-hmm. Like, my niece, I, like, took one of my old mirrors and, like, I spray painted it and I like glue flowers on it and everything. Like, doesn't look like the same old mirror it was, but yeah,
it's pretty cool. Yeah. It's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Just buying things, furniture, household appliances, like whatever, like making it better.
Yeah, like putting your personal touch on it.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the creative element for sure.
Yeah, for sure.
That's cool.
Yeah.
It's I respect that kind of like artsy, like. Interior design, kind of like decor.
I love that kind of stuff.
Having the knife for that's cool.
Yeah. Like, I can, like you said, like, you can see the big picture. So, like, I'm, like, redoing my room.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, I redid my dresser, and now I have, like, I bought a brand new mattress, and I was going to just use, like, one of the old frames that we have. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, my bed's too big for the frame that we have.
Right.
The other one's missing other parts, so I can't really use it. So then my mom's like, you can just buy one. And then I was like, no, I can make one. Like, I can make a nice fancy one versus buying a $500 one that I want. And so, like, in my mind, like, I can see it. And I can see what color it is, and then I can, like, see my bedspread and, like, how it's, like, all decorated. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you're kind of playing it out in your mind.
Yeah, like, it's there. It's just the steps.
Yeah, that's a skill. That's cool.
Yeah. It's weird to think about
that. A lot of these, I mean, creativity focused on the end result, like...
Yeah.
I think we just diagnosed you.
I think so. There we go. You should be a doctor.
Is it spatial intelligence? Is that what they said?
Yeah.
That'd be spatial, right? Like, being able to kind of imagine a room.
So, like, no. Like, spatial terms are kind of like, you know, like, your environment awareness, I guess. Well, I guess you're right. Yeah.
Would that be spatial imagination?
Me.
I don't know if I'm defining this right or not. I don't know.
No, like,
or if you are.
I mean, like, to me, like, because, like, I teach it to little kids in gymnastics, so, like, spatial terms are, like, when they, like, go upside down, like, their body is aware of, like, the space around them and where they're at.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not even going to say anything. but, you know, like,
she's about it, too.
She's just, like, hanging out in there.
I just put my dog in my hoodie. Just, like... she's just, like, fine with it.
I see her little paw, like, on the table. That's cute. Oh, my goodness. She's like, this is warm in here.
She's just fine with it. I thought she'd freak out a little bit. I've never done this before. This is funny.
But, you know, like, what were you talking about?
My bad.
You're good. spatial terms.
Uh-huh.
So, like, you know, like, just your body's awareness of your surroundings is what, you know, spatial awareness is.
Okay, absolutely.
But, yeah. I think that's right.
That makes sense.
I want to say that's right.
Maybe more, do you think that's more coordination?
Yeah, it's, like, more coordination and, like, just, like, being self-aware.
Okay.
Yeah. And would you learn that actually at, like, a very early age?
Spatial intelligence? Or mm-hmm. What? How so?
So, like, when... So, it's called the vestibular system. Oh, that is so cute. She's all about this.
She's poking her head out of the hole now.
She looks like she's about to fall asleep. Like, no joke. So, like, it's called the vestibular system, which is the fluid inside your ears. So, like, when, when we feel dizzy or imbalanced, or anything like that, like, vertigo and stuff like that, like, that's, like, the inner fluid in your ear, which is the vestibular system. So, like, when you're younger, you're not used to it, so you have to, like, make your body aware of it. So
absolutely.
So you, like, you know, spinning in a circle, doing, she's like, let me back out. doing, a somersault, like spinning or, rolling on the ground. Like, you know, when you're younger, you really feel that.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
She feels it too.
Yeah. She's like, I can.
Yeah. Yeah.
She's like, me too. But, like, yeah, so, like, you learn it at a very young age. Like, you might not know what it is until you get older.
And you're adapting to it a lot because it's so new.
Exactly. So, like, you're becoming more aware of your surroundings at a younger age, and you just don't realize it.
So it kind of ties in with coordination a little bit, too, and balance.
Balance, yeah. Yeah.
Okay, absolutely.
And, like, yeah.
I didn't know that till the other night that you have fluid in your ears that dictates your balance.
Really?
I'd literally learned that, like, 2 nights ago.
Huh.
That's really interesting.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like I've always known that, but that's probably because of gymnastics, though.
Like, somebody was telling me that you can inject a needle or something in somebody's ear and make them fall over immediately.
Because
it's, like, messing with their fluid in their ear that makes them fall.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah. When, like, have you ever had vertigo?
My grandma has it.
Yeah, so, like, that's, like, imbalanced fluid in your ears as well.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So, like, the fluid in your ears controls, like, your coordination and your balance.
That's crazy.
And it's crazy to think about. And, I mean, I don't know if this is true or not, but, like, I've heard that, like, your pinky toe, like, we couldn't stand without our pinky toe because that also creates our balance. I don't know if that's right.
Just the pinky toe.
Yeah.
So I've heard the big toe leads to a lot of balance, too, but that's... You think the pinky toe would be, like, the most, like, you know, just useless toe.
No, exactly. No, I don't know. I mean, that's what I heard.
Crazy.
It could be, like, you know, fake news or whatever, but...
Right. It's like one of those little fake stats that you hear. But no, that's crazy. I could see that being true, though.
Yeah. Because, I mean, like, I don't know. I, like, broke my pinky toe, like, at the bottom, and I kind of wear, like, a wooden shoe. And, like, it was very hard to, like, maybe adapt to it. But, like, it could have been, like, the wooden shoe as well. But it could have been the fact that I had a broken pinky toe and I couldn't really put a lot of weight on it. So, like... Walking through the hall, I was, like, constantly like this.
Especially, like, shifting off of that, like, a, you know, like, if you're going to push off of that to the side.
Yeah.
Any side-to-side movement with that pinky toe, that'd be difficult.
Yeah. And, like, I still, like, I get, like, ghost pains.
What's that?
So, like, a ghost pain is, like, a pain you felt before. Like, nothing's wrong. You just feel the pain.
Uh-huh.
Like, have you ever, like, gotten your appendix taken out?
No.
Any surgeries? Any injuries?
I've fractured my skull when I was, like, 3 or 4. That's it.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Do you have, like, a scar?
I don't think so, surprisingly.
Huh.
Not that I've ever... I think I've shaved my head close enough, too, that I would, like... I feel like I would know. I feel like I would know if I have a scar.
But I feel like...
I don't think I do.
But, like, scar... Like, scars, like, heal themselves over time. So, like, maybe, like, by now, like, it's probably, like, barely visible.
Right, because that's probably 20 years ago.
Yeah, like, you can't really see, but, like, I have, like, scars right here.
Uh-huh.
If you, like, look very close from, like, cartwheeling into a brick wall. In the corner of a brick wall, actually.
Wow.
Yeah, it was very smart of me to
do. That's impressive.
Yeah, I was, like, 3, and I was just, like, here's, like, the corner of the brick wall, and, like, I, like... did a cartwheel, and as soon as I turned my body, it just, like, was there, and it just went, whoosh, like, scratched me up. I had bruises all over me. Knocked the wind out of me. It hurts so bad.
It's crazy.
But, yeah, like, your skin, like, is, like, repairing itself, so, like, when you get a scar, like, it's also repairing. But, yeah, I mean, you might have one.
Yeah, that's good. Scars are interesting.
Yeah.
It's like a documentation.
Exactly. Like, I have one, on my right arm.
It's cool they, like, tell stories, too. Like, yeah. Like, every scar is kind of a story.
Yeah, like, this
some are
one,
embarrassing.
This
some.
One's the most embarrassing. I got it while doing laundry.
Ouch.
Yeah, and it's, like, it's like a nasty scar.
She's walking around on the table.
I mean, you can't see it anymore. Hi. But, like, it's, like, raised and everything. And it was because I took a sharp turn with a laundry basket,
mm-hmm.
and my arm, our banister was broke at the time, and my arm caught the metal part, and so, like, it's just, like, perfect angle, everything. It hurts so bad.
Ah.
Hi.
That looks like a deep scar.
Yeah, and I mean, I didn't get stitches or anything, but, like, it looks like I did.
Doing laundry.
Doing laundry. Exactly. I hated that thing so much, the banister. But, yeah.
I'm honestly down to call this quits if you want.
Same.
Are you hungry at all?
I am, actually.
Do you want to make some food upstairs?
Yeah.
Are you cool with that?
Yeah.
Okay. She wants some food, too. I love how every time she's whined so far on this, like, she's actually, it sounds like she's communicating, like,
yeah.
I'm hungry, too. Let's go make some food.
Are you hungry?
You want some food?
And your ball? Oh, she was like...
See if she'll play on the table. Anybody listening to this right now can't hear.
Yeah. She, like, won't go that way. But I noticed.
You're right.
Push it over here.
She's, like, committed to that side of the table. Now it's over here, and she's, like, this is stressing out.
Oh,
she came over a little bit.
She's waiting until it comes close, though. Get it, Charlie.
I just want to make these sounds. Oh, she's barking now. You chill out, dude. Hey.
She's pissed.
You can make her make some weird sounds because this dog is the highest pitch bark I've ever heard. It's kind of funny. You can make her make some weird sounds. Like if we start howling right now, she'd,
really do
she'd
it.
Be like,
do it.
Oh, I don't want you just because my dad's sleeping right above, right. But I would totally do it otherwise. It's funny because she'll just be like,
that's cute.
I'll try to do it like a quiet one. It's hard for me to either I could do it, yeah. Girl, good girl. That was good. That was good.
So cute. I'm obsessed.
It's crazy how it's like ingrained her. Like she looks up. She looks upward whenever she does it.
Yeah.
But like my other dog, like that was not like genetically in her at all. Like she never did that ever.
Yeah.
I mean, you could do other stuff with her, but like she.
She just wasn't about the howl life.
Mm-hmm. Like you could tell. Like this one seems like she was raised in more like primal than my other dog was.
Yeah.
Like I don't know. Like or like has like more like primal instincts than my other dog. Cause like she'll like do like. She like try to like whenever she pees on like the, say she pees on the carpet, she'll try to like bury it.
Like her?
Yeah, like she'll like use her paws to like it's like she's like attempting to bury her pee to like cover her smell, mm-hmm. But my other dog never did that, and then or maybe a little bit, not as much, and then just like little stuff like that you could like tell what she's going for, but it, like logically just doesn't make sense.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of interesting.
Mm.
Like that, she was like, she always looks upward. Whenever you make that sound, she always looks upward and howls upward.
I feel like a lot of dogs do that too.
So it's like howling at the moon.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Like a wolf.
Yeah. Crazy to think that this came from a wolf.
Yeah.
This tiny little dog.
She's like, what, 2 feet tall?
Really?
A foot tall?
All right, Charlie, should we call this quits? What do you think? I think that's a yes.
Sounds like a yes to me.
You're so cute. You're so cute. This is your first time ever talking on a podcast, isn't it, Charlie? Should I count her as a guest?
Yeah.
It's by the way, you're my 95th guest. It's kind of cool.
Who, me?
Yeah.
Or her?
I'm not counting her. I'm not counting her. She's not cool enough.
95th guest. Oh, I was almost 100.
Close.
Dang.
I think I'm gonna get to like 98 and then have two people on that are new, like the first time, and then make them duke it out for who's 100.
All right.
Like fight on the podcast, you know?
Yeah. Okay.
I'm just kidding. But cool. This is hey, you chill. Calm down. Alright. This has been fun. How long did we go? Went an hour and a half.
Nice.
Does that seem longer, shorter, like I always like to ask people that.
I feel like it's been like 3 hours.
Really?
Yeah.
Interesting.
I thought I was going to go by slow.
Okay. So it's the opposite of what you're thinking?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, some people say like, they'll say the opposite too. They'll be like, oh yeah, that felt like 10 minutes or like, that felt like 15 minutes. That's crazy. Like that much time just passed.
No, I felt like it was like 3 hours.
Yeah, it did seem like longer to me too.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Probably because we just like, bounced around from like subject to subject.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah.
And we talked about a lot of random shit.
We did. Talk about like Ariana Grande.
I
love her. I want to go see her.
Bay. Hashtag Bay.
Literally. No, she's like coming in April and I want to go see her so bad. I just haven't gotten the heart to pay, I think 70, I think it is, for crappy seats.
Oh, really?
Crappy seats. Like way up high seats.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow, she's making money.
Oh, for sure.
That's crazy.
And I'm like, I don't really want to bring myself to buy that. But then again, I'm like, I really want to.
Mm-hmm.
But I got some time.
True.
It's in April, so.
Well, with that being said, will she go to the concert or not?
We'll find out.
You decide. All right, cool. This has been fun. Thank you, Allie.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome. You're welcome. Yeah. I tried to like one up you with thanking you back, but.
But you can't.
Yeah, exactly.
But food.
Yes, food. That's what's on my mind right now, to be honest. All right, cool. See ya. Bye.